Tony?
I think this is the place.
Tony!
Lou!
All right.
Okay.
Tony! Sally? Anyone?
All right. Just hang out till he comes back.
It's not a video. It's the real thing. Funny faces and all. Holy shit, it's David Clark.
Why is he not waving back? Nice shirt. Oh, you like my shirt? Songs in the Attic.
Woo-hoo.
Featuring the music of Billy Joel. Piano. It says David Clark right there. That's him!
That's you.
Hello, everyone out in Tony Land. And since it is a Billy Joel shirt, you should open with Sting.
Should have you, because this guy Jeff Siegel's watching. He made fun of my gut, because like he doesn't have one, right, Jeff?
Hey, man.
And the song requests have already started.
Have they really?
Yes.
Wow. Keep them tracking, man. We'll write them down.
Kim Quaid Janssen. She wants Murder by Numbers.
Ooh.
Dennis Farrell wants us to do the Tonight Show in our undies. I would expect nothing less from Dennis Farrell. But, you know, I was there in my undies at his house all weekend. Because that's what we do on weekends, me and Dennis.
The human torch was denied.
Jeff Siegel said, Dave, blink 3 times if you're being held hostage.
No! No, it's fine. This good friend of ours here, he drove 2 freaking hours just to be here.
Thanks for that, though.
Well worth it, you kidding?
Well worth it.
I would have driven 2.5.
Nice.
Oh, yeah.
And it was probably harder for you to get here than it was for Elio, who came all the way from England, because New Jersey sucks. Yeah. Because, and this is exactly where Elio was. Well, no,
Jersey. You are not nice.
Not the people in Jersey, just like the highways and the weirdness of Jersey.
Yeah, no, not really. I've learned now that I live there, it's actually a falsehood.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. He's probably got a Springsteen tribute in the works now, too.
No! No. I tell you, it's not a bad idea. Because I'm such a genius that I started a Billy Joel tribute where there's 87 of them, I should start a Bruce tribute in Jersey with his 93 of them.
Well,
that's a business model, baby.
That's right.
You know what I'm doing.
Well, but you probably are, even though there's 1,800 Billy Joel tribute bands in New York, you're probably the only one who not only is in 2 Billy Joel tribute bands, but you're in 2 separate tribute bands. You're also a Sting guy. I mean, how many guys are in, you know, are leading 2 different tribute acts?
I don't know who I am anymore.
He's either Sting, or he's Billy Joel, or he's Captain Kirk.
I don't know what you're saying. Tell me. This painting is beautiful. I need this for my house.
Hey, see that? See, and now you can do Shatner made records. You can do a Shatner tribute.
Today we're going to feature a reading of Bad.
Can you see the floor? Can you see the floor?
Yeah, your leg is in the way of the floor, but yeah, we could see his coffee cup and.
Because there's a reason the Bad Kitty book is sitting there.
Yes.
Is there?
Yeah.
I know nothing of this story.
I think it was a skateboard that went through the
really?
Wall.
Really?
A yeah. skateboard went through the wall, so the Bad Kitty
when
book
I moved the book, I in fact saw a hole.
Little hole. It's just a small hole. It's just that they did it on this side of the wall, too, so mm-hmm. I just finished fixing that, so I'll wait. I'll wait for all the walls to have holes.
Hey, Bob Blinkwoody's watching.
Sweet! My man Bob! So ask me questions and unlock the mystery. That is David Clark.
I didn't know David Clark was a mystery.
I can't even unlock my phone. You can.
Well, speaking of Bob Blinkwoody, on this very show that you've been so nice enough to let us, you know, use a video of you without permission, without I've totally chopped up and messed with, but in return, I'm always pushing whatever you have going on. I give out, you know, almost all of your show dates, and I was pushing for weeks. The Bob Blinkwoody show that you just did. What is it? The Remember When concert series?
This is actually Bob's idea. And a good idea. What it is it kind of lined up because I was at a point with my own band where I was trying to figure out something cool to do.
His own band.
That's my shirt.
Not his shirt. It's a shirt of his that I bought.
And so Bob calls me. Dave, Bob Blinkwoody here. Got an idea. So he told me his idea of wanting to sort of try to find a way to recreate classic concerts, live experiences. And I was cool with it as long as it didn't come off like a reenactment in a physical sense or a costume sense or a scripted sense. I just wanted to play those set lists. So the first song we did out of the gate was Last Play at Shea, which we thought would be cool because it was a Billy Joel show at its core, but it had a bunch of other guys that are friends of ours that we brought in.
Right.
To do the Steven Tyler and all the other sort of
Daltrey, right.
Tributes that were that could pull off the people that were Billy's guests that night, which was pretty cool. So, and this is Bob's baby, so he chose me as his first victim.
And it went so well, he did a second one.
We did a second one
last week. Excuse me, they did the live from Long Island, 1982. Well, it was filmed in 82, came out in 83. VHS. Who remembers VHS? Was probably one of the early days of rock and roll.
And Laserdisc. Frickin' Laserdisc. And it was an HBO special. And I remember being upset because I was at the show. So when they released the video, I'm like, this is not the whole show. And it was more than just Until the Night they left off. They left off a lot of songs.
Oh, yeah.
So I actually researched and dug and found the actual real set list, including everything they did that night. So that's what we did last Friday. Went very well.
It did go very well. Yes, the Landmark Theater in Port Washington.
Landmark on Main.
Yep. Hey, Jeff Siegel is saying that you push David's shows to get free tickets, but that is not true because we always pay for our tickets.
We do. We do pay for our tickets.
Yeah. Jeff.
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 Well, Jeff is giving us free tickets. That's our pay as we plug one of our own things. The Lords, the other Billy Joel show you're in, is playing at the Space February 23rd?
Correct.
If you go to if you know the Space, you know that there's a little area on the side called the Lounge. Beautiful bar area, great couches, great atmosphere. I love that. But that night, yours truly and Sally will be hosting a little Billy Joel trivia show that night before the Lords go on. Did you know that?
I did.
Oh, you did? Okay.
You told me.
I got all excited.
That's how I know. that's gonna be a beast. That band's fun, man. That's cool.
The Lords of 52nd. Cool, for those of you who don't know what the Lords of 52nd Street are, that's Russell Javers, Richie Cannata, and Liberty DeVito. Three guys that played with Billy Joel back in his heyday. Right? Would you say that would be Billy Joel's heyday? Or?
Yeah, I would say arguably his prime.
Right. Scenes from an Italian restaurant. You may be right. All those, it's still rock and roll to me. All those classic songs, Only the Good Die Young. These guys played on those tunes, New York State of Mind, and they're playing, they came together to play those songs again, and they brought on David Clark here to take on the piano vocal duties.
If the subsequent incarnations of Billy's band were the Next Generation and DS9, they were Kirk, Spock, and McCoy. They were the original series of Billy Joel bands.
And now he's geeking out on me.
Completely. I'm just waiting to get there, man. I'm dying to talk about this stuff. Yeah, Billy Joel. Star Wars, come on!
All right.
No, I'm kidding.
No, we can get to Star Wars. Before I do that, there's just one thing I have to mention, because I'm going to forget otherwise. A big supporter of our show, Melissa...
I was just going to do that. I was going to say anything. I can't do it.
Her and her husband, Teddy, they host a radio show called Songs from the Attic.
Mm-hmm.
Not Songs in the Attic, Songs from the Attic.
In Syracuse, right?
In Syracuse, mm-hmm. Yes. Sally and I actually drove up there over the summer, and we guested on one of their shows, and we just talked Billy Joel for an hour. We did play a couple of tunes mm-hmm. that you are on. We lifted the audio from some live videos.
That's cool.
It was very cool.
Boy Low.
Okay, Boy Low. Hello, Melissa Boy Low. Melissa is a big supporter of our show. She brings it up on her radio show a lot. Her and Teddy watch our show almost weekly, and they were very excited to hear that you were on. Melissa even just said, David, I hope to meet you someday or something like that, she said.
And come to your show.
Well, my wife's from Buffalo, so...
Yeah, you might.
On our way, next time we're going and coming to and from Buffalo.
She does it Sunday morning at 10.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm kidding.
Dave wakes up at 11:30.
Jeff said we also have to clean the bathrooms that night.
Like we don't do that every time we're there anyway.
Stephen Folletti is watching. The guy, Stephen Folletti. We got to get Stephen Folletti at a Songs in the Attic show. Stephen Folletti, he just kind of imposes himself on Big Shot, and he jumps up on stage and plays harmonica for Piano Man. And
it's very cool.
It is cool, but Steven is like, he's like the Bruce Springsteen of harmonica players. He gets up there and he just sets himself up and he just gives it all he's got on the harmonica. Like he's like violently beating it up, and he makes all the faces and... Yeah. You know, then he waves everybody in the crowd.
He has angry sex with the harmonica.
Angry sex with the harmonica. great show. Dennis Farrell said he is... What'd you say, Dennis? You spent like $2,000 a year on Billy tickets? Is that... That's just stupid.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
No, that's not stupid. It's a fan, man.
I know.
Devoted, just a devoted fan, bro.
I'm just picking on Dennis.
Yeah,
$2,000, he said. Around $2,000. Lisa Madigan Rosengarten is watching.
Woo!
It's
my wife watching. You seen Cindy?
I did see her name.
Yeah,
earlier.
She came on really.
Love you, sweetheart.
We love you,
Kenny
Cindy.
Friedman. Kenny Friedman. Hi, Kenny. You know Kenny?
Yeah, I know who that is. Yeah, sure.
I've known Kenny for like 30 years. He says, Cindy should get on camera. Kenny, if she was here, trust me, she would be on camera instead of these bald heads. But she's not here. But we will. Let's talk about Cindy Bradley.
Yeah!
Cindy Bradley is a top charted artist in the jazz charts. Did that come out right? You know what I mean. She's got albums topping the jazz charts. She is phenomenal. And she's also Dave's
wife.
She plays with Songs in the Attic.
Trumpet.
Trumpet. David almost didn't play Zanzibar the other night.
Yeah.
What was that?
That's just crazy.
Cindy Bradley's in the band. You gotta play Zanzibar.
Here's what we did.
Cindy just said, it's about time we focus on Cindy Bradley.
Well, you know, when we decided to do that show, I realized kind of in hindsight, when I say hindsight, I realized while we were playing the show that I went, oh crap, she's not really playing on a lot of these songs. Yeah. So it was such a fun audience and such a wild audience that by the end of the night, after we did Where's the Orchestra and Souvenir,
yeah.
You guys saw what I did. I brought the band down. We just did sort of two bonus encore songs.
Yes.
So we brought, you're right, you got to have Zanzibar.
Cindy Bradley's there, you got to play have Zanzibar. It's that simple.
Cindy Bradley's mommy's on too.
Oh, hi, Cindy Bradley's mommy.
Oh, watch your language.
We can't say bad words.
All right, how are we looking here, Mike?
Doreen, I apologize.
Yeah, that looks good. Oh, okay, the bird's on your shoulder.
Yes, I'm showing your family.
Oh, that's yeah.
This is the Clark family, ladies and gentlemen. Mm-hmm.
It's the Bradley family.
What did I say?
You said Clark.
Oh,
you know
Clark
what? I
Bradley
always
family.
Wanted to know.
I got rid of my maiden name.
When it comes to birds, how did you get into bird ownership? Because that's a really big commitment. Don't they live 1,482 years?
They live, they're eternal. They are actually immortal.
Yeah.
They don't ever die.
Have you always wanted birds?
No, you know what? The African gray.
Tony, come on. I always wanted to know this.
No, that African gray, I got him when he was a baby. In the year 2000, he's now obviously 17, he's going to obviously be 18. So I got him after he was a fresh.
He's the same age as Sam.
Ah.
Mm-hmm.
And they live till approximately 65 or more. Now.
Really?
Yeah.
See, now so, we're interested, aren't we? Okay.
There are some pets that are a great idea at the time, because you don't think that far ahead to realize what effect.
That's what Sally says about
that
me.
An immortal pet is going to have on your life, unlike, say, a dog or a cat. So, but he's great. Mojo's cool. He's a pretty fluent English speaker.
Uh-huh.
Does some funny things. He's a good boy.
Did you see what Jeff said?
What?
Jeff said Sally's a better host.
Sally's a much better host. Yay! Thanks. I just got fired.
Oh, snap.
All right, so we made fun of you for almost dropping Zanzibar, but... So let's turn the tables here.
Okay.
How come David Clark is not on Cindy Bradley's last album? You did get a mention. You're mentioned in the liner notes. You know, the little thank yous. But
well,
now I'm getting my ass kicked by Cindy.
Is she saying anything, honey?
She's locking the door and
no. No, it just kind of didn't. Come up. Her last album came out last year, we knew each other and worked together and that kind of thing, and we're friends and stuff. But we weren't close enough yet where she felt that I was good enough to play a jazz.
Cindy said it was the dark time.
It was a very dark time.
Marianne Stone wants to know if we're taking requests.
Yeah.
Type them in. I mean, I doubt we're going to get to all of them, but yeah, hit us with some requests. We already got one for Murder My Numbers. Maybe we'll get to it, maybe not. But yeah, type in your requests if you want. Also, hit in those, type in, you know, click on the hearts and the likes and share and all that good stuff. Share the page. Tell everybody you know. Let's get a lot of people watching. But yeah, hit us with requests. Dave could only play chopsticks.
Who said that?
Jeff Siegel said that.
Oh, okay.
Hey, you know what? I read it wrong. Cindy said that her last album was done in 2013.
Right.
And no David was in my life then.
Oh, so it just came out
so
last year?
So that's why it was a dark time.
It just came out last year.
No, the last album, honey, the last CD came out and we weren't really, like, that was already done
Right, that was already done.
Okay. Like, the process of making, recording, writing, pressing photo shoots actually takes a while.
Oh, yeah.
So, I hadn't done my mind trick on her. You don't need any more keyboard players. I'm the one you're looking for.
Speaking of mind tricks, aha! As I mentioned, Sidney Bradley is his wife. They just got married this past August. Mm-hmm. I thought I got that wrong for a second. All right, so again, I'm going to try and, because I don't have the screen. This is an actual photo from their actual wedding. They had a Star Wars wedding. They had a Star Wars wedding. I kid you not.
In Vegas, right?
In Vegas. Which I have, by the way, you hear squeaking. I'm not farting. My prosthetic is loose and I'm having issues. It might just fall off, and I'm not kidding. It might just fall off, which would make for great video. So hopefully it does.
That wedding. I apologize in advance, Dorian, if you're watching this. That wedding was badass. That wedding was amazing. It was the most fun time.
Even badass? Your mother-in-law's going to get upset with?
Dorian's awesome.
Oh, I didn't say
Dorian's
she's
amazing.
Not.
And,
You have to say bad bottom.
Bad bottom. Bad butt. It was bad butt. What was so bad butt about it? Well, it's a Star Wars wedding in Vegas.
Star Wars wedding in Vegas, dude.
But it has David Clark written all over it. So this was obviously your idea.
No. Believe it or not, okay, my wife is kind of a nerd like I am with that stuff. And the original plan was to go to Vegas, and it was going to be Elvis.
Right.
It was going to be like this. We were going to like cheese it out, man. It was going to be like an Elvis wedding with that whole thing. And when we were looking up theme weddings, Star Wars theme was actually her idea.
Wow.
And I went, yeah, okay.
But you didn't post the video, right?
The video.
We saw the video.
Actually, it might even still be there. I don't know how long they archived it, but the day we got married, they live streamed it from the Viva Las Vegas Wedding Chapel.
Right.
We watched it.
Which is how we saw it.
But yeah, that's what losers we are. We actually sat here and watched it on live streaming.
We're watching our friends. We're supporting
them.
Yeah, wow. It was Sally. Like,
everyone, turn the phone off. Turn everything off.
Well, yeah, it was fun because they actually walked in to Star Wars music, and they had the outfits that you saw in the picture. Like Darth Vader, he was breathing. He had the guy had the voice down pretty well, and performed the ceremony. It was pretty wild.
Yeah.
Just as fun was getting dressed at Luxor, walking out of the elevators and through a lobby in full costume, and no one batting an eye.
That's cool.
That was pretty cool.
I've never been to
Vegas. It was 100 fulfilling degrees out, man. It was great. It was a great time. Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, it's great.
And then the honeymoon, you went on a cruise?
Yeah. We went on a cruise a couple of weeks later. And the funny thing is the cruise was planned and became a honeymoon cruise because we planned the cruise first.
Ha-ha.
Long trivia. So shortly after we planned the cruise, we then decided to get married and plan that wedding, and the cruise became a honeymoon. So it was awesome.
All right. So... Yeah. I saw it on here. Doreen says she loves you. She said it.
Doreen's awesome.
Yeah, there it is.
Doreen's amazing.
Love you. I'm assuming she's talking to David. Maybe she's talking to me.
So it's probably us.
Song request. Dennis Farrell says, Marianne Stone says Thunder Road. Dennis Farrell says say goodbye to Hollywood.
Okay.
Liz Weingart. Hi, Liz. She wants to know if David has ever composed any original music.
Can we address that later in the interview?
We can address that later in the interview. Somewhere along the line, Patty Hopkins Maroney. Love you, David Clark. You're awesome. Do you know Patty?
Patty's amazing.
She's a good singer. Yeah, she's a friend. Well, we have a lot
of
more mutual friends than I thought.
Of my long list of favorite people, Patty is one of my favorite people. She's on that list.
Wow, underneath me. Moving on.
It's not pushing.
Marianne Stone wants to hear Englishmen in a New York State of Mind.
Okay, put the bong down.
Stick to the camera. Take the picture. Thank you, Marianne. Then she said, Viva Las Vegas. Michael Salce says, how are you doing? Salce? S-A-L-C-E? Mike, if you're a friend of mine, I apologize. I don't recognize the name. You got it?
Here's the problem.
Just say yes. Hey, Mike, good to see you.
Mikey!
Mike!
What's up?
Jack Scala's watching.
Jack!
Oh, is Jack?
How is it possible that Jack and I are not friends on Facebook?
Oh, what's that?
Do you know that Jack Scala and I are actually not friends on Facebook?
How is that possible?
Yeah. I don't know.
Jack's another super, super nice man.
It upsets me.
Lisa Madigan Rosengarten wants to hear David play the trumpet.
Gary Gonzalez is watching.
Gary Gonzalez is
Gary! Great.
Leonard Tabone is watching. Pam Markoff is watching. Pam Markoff lives in England. So thank you, and she watches almost every week. I don't know, Pam, do you not sleep?
It's too late. Go to sleep.
I know, it's crazy. But thank you, Pam, for watching. Do you want to play one of those?
Yes, do a song.
All right, pick one, any of those or none of those?
I'm going to go for one of those.
He's going for one of those. David Clark, ladies and gentlemen. Really, I love that. I'm dead serious. I love that. I regretted actually doing my little guitar solo because I ruined what I thought was a great rendition of Thunder Road.
Ah, that's no problem.
What is, there's a little...
It's a very good chatter, I'm impressed.
What is your Bruce connection?
I have none.
Yes, you do.
I have a Bruce connection?
You do.
Do I?
The Lord show at the Cutting Room, not the one you just did a couple months ago, like a year ago. The man who produced Born to Run was there.
I did not know that.
Mike Appel.
Oh, okay.
You met Mike that night?
I think so. I met a lot of people, man.
You have no idea what I'm talking about.
No.
He was there.
I met Gene Roddenberry, yeah.
Did you?
No.
Oh. I met Leonard Nimoy.
Did you?
I was, I think, Frank, are you watching? How old were we when we met Leonard Nimoy?
Uncle Joe's watching.
Uncle Joe's watching? He wasn't there. It was my mother. I saw Tammy's watching, so maybe she's with Frank. Tammy, ask Frank how old we were when we met Leonard Nimoy. I was little. I was very little, and I was all upset. I didn't recognize him because he didn't have the pointy ears. That's how little I was. That was great.
Thanks.
Yeah, but Leonard Taboni said, wow, I can actually understand the words.
Like, you know, I had it in front of me and screwed it up, man.
And
I don't memorize things.
And Dennis Farrell said, this Bruce guy is never going to take off.
Jack says, hello. Marianne, you made Marianne's day by playing
this. Woo!
Let's see, wasn't that? Oh, Leonard is, Leonard's request is James.
Really?
Yep. all right, so keep the requests coming, keep hitting the hearts and the likes, and keep sharing this show. All right, I'm going to put David on the spot. I've been showing some photographs.
Oh, boy.
And I have, I think, one or two more. again, Dave has this great band, Songs in the Attic. Now, there was a picture I saw. I always compare myself, I see a lot of, in your shows, sorry, I'm all over the place. In your shows, when I watch your shows, yeah. I see a lot of what I do, I see a lot of similarities. You're very intense, you're watching the band, you're having a great time,
yeah.
But your eyes and ears are everywhere.
You're working.
And Sally will verify this, my guys, there's like a little inside joke within Knockin' Dead Comedy, that when somebody flubs, like messes up a line or they jump ahead or something, that they get the Tony face. I don't even know I'm doing it. So today I'm, you know, doing my research as a good host should, and I came across a photo.
Uh-oh.
I'll show it here first. It's some members of David Band, and they're doing what they're calling in the caption, their David face. I'm putting David on the spot. Do they get the same face when there's what's the meaning behind this photo, Dave?
Well, he's working and he's
absolutely. I'm not knocking the guy. I do it too. I think
the serious answer to that question is. With Songs in the Attic, I wear a lot of hats.
Absolutely.
I'm the singer in the band. I'm the artist in the band. I book the band. I handle the band's business. I organize things. I send out emails. I send out set lists. And sometimes I get like that. And sometimes there's a Dave face. It doesn't happen a lot. But I guess once in a while I'm guilty of a Dave face. And I would just say if all three of those guys are making a Dave face, there's a good chance I have to be self-aware enough to understand that I make a Dave face.
Jeff Segel said it's the same face he makes when he's on the toilet bowl.
And Jeff would know.
Oh, stop!
and you know, I'm messing with you, but... And again, I make the same face too. But I also am the first to say I have the best guys, and that's why we're the best comedy troupe. And I can say the same about you guys. The guys in that photo, Gary Gonzalez is a monster. Kenny Sino, you're not going to get a better local guy in guitar. And Mike Jewell, who, by the way, the other night, you guys played the Billy Joel song, Scandinavian Skies, which probably only two or three people watching right now know that song. And Mike Jewell, the whole band.
It's probably at least five watching. But no. but no.
You guys nailed the song. Jewel's largely in parts of like, Mike Jewell.
You know, it's good to reprogram yourself once in a while. And that's another reason why I wanted to do the Life on Long Island show. I wanted to play with the orchestra. I wanted to do those songs. And they're fun, man. I'm going to keep playing. And Jules, smoke the Jules, just, you know, there's some great people in this band over, you know, over the past 6-7 years. And I put a post about this the other day.
You did.
Jules the man, you know. Gary's my best friend. And Kenny's badass.
Absolutely. And that's not to get off topic here, but that's kind of like the beauty of of Facebook, you know, because... You did post the other day, but you mentioned a bunch of people that have been in the band, played with the band, and it was nice because for me personally to read that post because you guys were all friends. So was the Addict started with 2011.
Yeah.
What was the first time you played Jones Beach?
2011.
That week. 2011.
Because I think I saw you there, and that was before I knew you. And then you know here we are. You know, 6 years later, and you're one of my closest friends, and I can call everybody in the band a friend of mine, which I think, and it's all because of Facebook, it's all because of social media.
More than the musical part, and as much as the gigs, like what starting this band has gotten me, it got me the Lords, it's got me some pretty cool stuff. It got me, I played shows with Billy's first incarnation of his band with Elio.
Right.
So I know you discussed this. I played in the band with Larry Russell. Reese Clark. Now, Al Hertzberg, they couldn't get a hold of him. These are the guys that did Sigma.
Right.
If I didn't do songs in the attic, none of that stuff happens. I don't meet any of you guys.
Right.
You know.
Right.
So I'm happy with it. It's become something I didn't think it was going to become.
Much bigger monster, and it's great.
Not about that, but it's people. Yeah, it's getting higher.
What was your first professional job as a musician?
My first professional job as a musician was with a company called Stephen Scott Orchestras, and this is back in the late 80s. And what happened is, I was, for 1 year I went to college. One, I went to the New York Institute of Technology in Central Islip.
Oh, yeah.
Hated it. And interesting thing, my parents kind of did a flip. My father was like encouraging me to play music, and my mom was like, go to college. And then at one point, they kind of flopped roles, and my father got petrified when I left college, and my mom said, go play.
Oh, wow.
So that was the interesting thing, and it was with Stephen Scott Orchestras, and what happened is, as my older brother Jimmy had gotten married in 85,
okay,
and a Stephen Scott band played that wedding, and it was a good friend of our families was the band leader, this guy named Lou Davis. So my brothers and I, we were all like little cow sills, we were like a little Partridge Family. So we played at my brother's wedding, and Lou Davis kind of hired me there, and I started off being the band boy schlep with the equipment, and I learned songs, and I got my ass kicked. They threw me on gigs where I got beaten, I didn't know tunes, but I learned. So like anything else in life, if you do something with guys and girls that are just way better than you, you'll get better the next time you do that, and you won't make
absolutely
those mistakes again.
Right.
So
that's
how it started. So I was a singer and a keyboard player in a Stephen Scott band, and that's how I cut my teeth. How it started. 85, 86.
And it went from there? Like, you never worked at Home Depot? Or?
Do you remember the scene in the movie?
No.
Come on! The scene in the movie Big, where Tom Hanks becomes a kid, and he's working, he gets his first paycheck, and goes, $187! That's what it was like when I got my first Stephen Scott check. And I'm like, yeah, I'm doing this, man. This is great. You can play, get paid. It's awesome.
Wow.
So that's how that started. And I learned weddings back then. And I learned how to, like, run a wedding and play a wedding. And it kind of, that sort of grew from there. And it was an amazing blessing and an amazing curse all at the same time. But I'm serious. There's a reason why. I don't get too deep yet. But
okay.
This is a comedy show, damn it.
So the answer would be no.
To what?
That you never worked any other job.
Oh, yes, I did.
Oh, you did?
I did. Back in the day.
Oh, the stripper, right, yeah.
I was young, you needed the money.
Thank you. To make a gun, we just watched that the other night.
Back in the day in a neighborhood I grew up in. I grew up in the Duncan Estates area of Hempstead, right by Hofstra University. And on the corner of Hempstead Turnpike, right by that Hofstra overpass back in the day, was a Jack in the Box.
Oh, I know.
It ended up becoming an Arby's. So in my teens, I worked at Arby's for like a couple of years, and that's how I learned like working skills.
Oh, that's right. We've seen pictures on Facebook.
I worked at Arby's. I worked with my older brothers at a pet food distributor warehouse where I loaded pallets and stuff and went on deliveries at that site. I had real jobs.
Oh, okay. So at what point were you able to
call a real job? Yeah.
A real job.
To call a real job.
At what point did you say? At what point did you realize I don't have to work at the pet place anymore? I can just play my tunes.
$97. That was the point. And I knew that if I learned it, that I'd be fine. I never wanted to do anything else. You know, and the thing is, it's like the Billy Joel culture when I was 10, that's when I knew I wanted to play. I knew I was really, you know, when you're 10, you think you want to, you know what you want to do with your life, but I did.
Right.
I had already been taking piano lessons for 3 years, so in 77, when A Stranger came out, I lost my shit. I heard Just the Way You Were. I'm like, what is this?
Doreen's watching.
Doreen, I'm sorry!
He lost his...
Poo-poo.
Poop.
Okay. So I knew, you know, what I wanted to do. My dad did it. My family all played. My older brother's a drummer. Rest his soul, my older brother was a bass player.
Oh, okay.
My little brother played, and Jennifer sings and played flute. So a whole family played and sang. So I say Kelsall's kidding, but not really. We were like a little family band. My cousin played guitar.
Oh, that's cool.
We played block parties. We played high school talent shows. So that's I knew I'd end up there, and deep down, I think my parents did too. So my older brother Jimmy did it for a while, played professionally, drummer.
Oh, wow.
He, by choice, got out of it, got married and got out of it. So that's the long-winded answer to your question.
And I listened to every bit of it. Which I'll mention, though, that since you're talking about winning bands, we got to mention Renegades.
Yeah.
David's wedding band. Phenomenal wedding band as well.
Yeah.
Where do you mostly do your wedding shows?
Weddings are all over the place. I mean, I would say we're probably 65-70% Long Island and 30% other. And that could be Jersey. Not a lot of Manhattan weddings. We do a good amount of Long Island, a lot of the temple work. We do a lot of the catering halls, a good amount in Jersey. Mm-hmm. Fair amount. I have an office in Melville and an office in New York City where I meet clients, meet brides there. That's that.
Just going to quickly say hello to everybody who's watching. Sue Fascino is watching. Vincent in... How do you say Vincent's last name?
Susan, how are you?
Vincent Innocente?
Vinny Innocente, baby.
Is that my saying his
Vincenzo
name?
Innocente.
Lisa Ciccio is watching from in Florida.
How Frank, you doing, Lisa? She's in Florida still?
She's in Florida. Frank is watching. Hi, Frank. Frank, how old were we met Leonard Nimoy? I'm trying to find out here. Hope you're feeling good. Frank is back in the hospital. He's recuperating and... He gets to sit back and relax and watch this. Danielle Benya is watching. Hello,
hey.
Danielle. Paulie G. Jacoby is watching.
Paulie!
Do you know Paulie?
I know who Paulie is.
Everybody knows Paulie.
Who doesn't know Paulie?
And same thing, like Henny Freeman, I go back like 30 years with Paulie. Carol Miner. Hi, Carol. She wants to hear Zanzibar. Andrew Bacon is watching. David Geyser is watching. Shari Fain says hello. Hello, Shari.
Shari!
Mike Stutz is watching.
Stutz!
Sari says hello to us. Dennis Farrell says, great neighborhood. I guess he's talking about your stomping grounds.
I'm going to tell you something, man.
Tell us something, man.
No, that neighborhood in Hempstead, the Duncan Estates area, was amazing. I wouldn't change a thing growing up back then in the neighborhood. It's amazing, amazing upbringing. Great
back
friends.
Then.
Yeah.
Hey, Kenny Cito is watching.
Woo! I'm sorry. Woo! Woo! But Kenny!
The first thing I think of when I hear Kenny Cino is,
that's
right,
the
little Kenny jig that he always does every show he's in. He just sits there somewhere he has to go like this.
Dedicate that to Kenny.
I guess that's a little inside joke.
Still stings.
Oh yeah, Shape of My Heart.
Yeah.
But I was just wondering why he was.
I love doing that band with him.
Yeah.
This thing, but Kenny just he just gets it, man.
Oh, he says hi.
It's great
Kenny's
stuff.
Kenny's amazing.
So Jeff Siegel is now screaming for Freebird.
Jeff Wood.
Well, Kenny does play a massive. Did you ever hear him do Freebird? He does it with Big Shot. If you know, I can mention Big Shot.
That's a very cool arrangement they do with that song, actually.
Yeah.
Don't they mix that with the end of
We Didn't Start the Fire? Yeah, and Kenny just goes nuts on Freebird. And I'm gonna go out on a limb, and I don't mean to upset people, but he kicks Tommy Burns' ass, man. Tommy Burns does it well too when he's playing
get
the big
a
shot.
Lot of letters
Kenny
now.
Cino, sorry. Kenny Cino kicks ass on Freebird. Sorry, Tommy, but he does.
This Facebook live feed will self destruct.
Man!
I had to say it. I'm one of Kenny's biggest fans, man. He's awesome.
Yeah. All right.
Yes. You want to get some Star Wars out of the way?
Anything you... Yeah.
Well, all right.
You wanted to... Sure, I guess I can discuss Star Wars.
What'd you think of The Last Jedi?
Here's what I've learned now that we're a few weeks in. What I've learned is I'm a huge Star Wars fan, and I'm one of the few big Star Wars fans who love the movie. A lot didn't.
Last Jedi.
A lot of people I've spoken to didn't like. We're like, yeah, it's cool. I actually loved it. I had two nitpicks. We're safe enough a few weeks and we can discuss this. You're a Star Wars fan and you haven't seen it yet, don't go, I haven't seen it yet.
It's already made over $1 billion in the box office, yeah. So I think it's safe to say that almost everybody has seen it now.
Here's what I didn't like. Or I should say, one thing I didn't like, one thing that has me a concern. What I didn't like is that the scenes in the beginning with Rey and Luke on the island.
Yeah.
That was impossible, the most unfindable place in the galaxy.
Right.
Took too long. Like, all right, we get it. Luke doesn't want to train her. Luke doesn't want to do it. But that they could have chopped 10 minutes out of that whole subplot.
Yeah, I agree.
And I love some of the choices the movie made, but my concern is they blew up so much of what got set up in The Force Awakens. Where are you now going to go in the next movie? But I feel like JJ can do something radical. JJ does radical stuff. JJ killed Han Solo. JJ blew up Vulcan. JJ is fearless. So, like, that's the only thing is, like, with Snoke dead, and which I thought was great. He got caught monologuing. It was awesome. there's a lot. I pretty much loved it. A lot of people didn't like the Luke character. I did. I dug it. I thought it was really, really different.
I agree with Dennis Farrell. The flying Princess Leia thing was... I did the same thing. I was like, what the hell
is that?
It
was very emotional. Here's the thing. And I'm going to say this.
Say it.
And I'll deal with the backlash later. What I'm saying is it probably was more moving because she's dead. She's actually dead, Carrie Fisher. So maybe, because did you know Carrie Fisher's dead?
I didn't see that yet.
Okay. No, it didn't bother me. Like, we had Ewoks, man. We've had other movies with cheesier shit.
That bothered me, too. Those little characters.
Loved them.
I hated them.
They were cool.
I hated them.
That thing that, like, he squeezed the milk out of. That was sick. Okay, but I dug the movie. Assuming they're telling the truth, I like how they dealt with Rey's lineage. We're done with this Chosen One Skywalker thing now, and anybody can be a rebel and anybody can be a hero. So I kind of like that part. I'm not convinced yet that Kylo Ren is a menacing enough bad guy to carry the next movie.
Well, and I think I think they're showing that on purpose, I think, right?
I think on purpose, but I have to say, I thought it was great, man. I loved it.
So let me ask you this, then, Star Wars expert.
Yes, sir.
What... Do you think that Rogue One came in the middle of this new trilogy for a reason? And I'll tell you why I'm asking.
For a reason? Meaning, did they choose to tell, like, as far as an anthology Star Wars movie, you know how they're down, they have a hand on this, right? They're doing a chapter anthology, chapter then anthology. That's how they're doing this. So every year there's a new Star Wars movie. You get that, right?
Yeah.
So there was Episode 7, Force Awakens, then Rogue One. Now there's Last Jedi, then Solo.
Right, which is right.
Then it's going to be Episode 9, and then whatever they're doing then. It's either that or Kenobi.
Oh, okay.
I'm hearing rumors. So you think that there's a reason why they released Rogue One before this?
I forget what they're called, but
okay.
But Kylo Ren has that, which I don't think they've shown in this movie. The story though goes, he has like this group of, what are they called? The Knights of Ren. Who look just like...
You don't know me. I was never here.
But they look just like the characters from Rogue One. Those guys that were helping... the ones that were helping the main character out. You know, the one guy, I am one with the Force, the Force is with me. And that whole group. They look... If you look at their photos, they have the same outfits.
I don't think so. Interesting theory, but I'm not...
It's not my theory. It's my son's.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
I know what you're saying. I'm not sure if I agree.
Okay.
Rogue One had very little mythology in it. Mythology. There was not, outside of the Darth Vader scene at the end, there was no sabers, there was no force usage, there was not a lot of that. So it was a different kind of movie. I don't know. Interesting.
The crowd's starting to talk about
it. Yeah, Marianne Stone is falling asleep.
They can't take it any, not one more second.
All right. So, Leonard wanted James. You know, Kenny Sino, are you still watching? Give us a request.
Kenny fell asleep, man.
Rogue One was just a movie. Move along.
Right. No, it was real. Star Trek is real. You don't get it. None of you get it. None of you can.
All right. I don't know if Kenny's still watching. Kenny says, I need to dust my room. All right, there you go.
here.
He's not here.
I know.
He's not here. Okay. It's almost 10 o'clock. So, it is time. It is time, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, man, I stink at trivia! All right, go ahead.
All right, quickly before I get to trivia, there was one last photo that I have to share.
Okay.
Because it has to do with me. Ooh. It's this great photo. The best picture ever of David wearing this fantastic shirt. Knock a Dead Comedy, baby.
With a propeller coming out of my head. Dave.
That's how you got here. You flew.
You got ceiling fan blades in your head.
It's a new Star Wars character. All right, yes. This is what we do every week. With all of our guests, we hit them with rapid-fire trivia questions. Oh. It has nothing to do with the guests, has nothing to do with anything, nothing to do with the show, nothing to do with you. Just pick these questions out of nowhere. If you feel you know the answers, do not Google them. Just type them in, and I'll tell you if you're right or wrong, and we'll get to this. New show Tuesday night without Tony. God, I hate Jeff.
That's so him.
So hey, go! You know, let me know. Let me know what you guys think of, doing the Billy Joel trivia before the Lord. So I hope it's a good idea. I hope it works out. I hope you guys come out to
participate. Oh, it will work. Oh, yes.
You're the man, Dave.
Oh, yes.
David's always very supportive of Knocking Dead Comedy in our endeavors. He's the best. All right, so we're just going to hit with some random trivia. There might be some questions that Dave, on topics Dave might know about, they might not. We'll see.
Don't count on it, man.
All right, here we go. First question. Dave will be all over this. Thomas Jefferson and John Adams died on the same day. True or false? Thomas Jefferson and John Adams died on the same day. True or false?
True.
It is true. Second part to that question, what day was it? Think about it.
Yeah, it was cool. It was like the 4th of July or something like that.
It was the 4th of July.
It was the 4th of July.
Was it?
Yes. I got both right.
1826, the 4th of July. Okay.
Now ask them of what?
that I didn't put down. John the Spin is watching. Hi, John. You know John?
Yeah.
Grew up with John. He's awesome.
Facebook rocks, man.
Did you ever play with Rubik's Cube?
I did. A long time ago.
John wasn't sure when I was hanging with John a few weeks ago. He said he thinks you did. He wasn't sure.
I filled in at the Canal Room on a few gigs.
But John was not there, he said.
Really?
Somebody else was drumming that day, so he's dying to play with you.
It was Michael who drummed.
It was Michael.
It was Manson. It was Mike.
That guy.
Yep.
Who voiced Esmeralda in the 1996 Disney movie, The Hunchback of Notre Dame? Oh, Frank from Grand Slam Collectibles. He knew it was July 4th.
Meryl Streep.
It's a good guess.
Because what can't she do? Let's be honest.
That's good. I'm skipping. What is the technical term for armpit?
Axilla. I don't know.
How the hell did you know that?
Yeah, three. Because that's bad.
You're a geek.
No, I don't know. I know science, sorry.
A bronze statue of whom stands at the foot of the steps to the Philadelphia Art Museum? Come on, you know this. You know this, David Clark. You know this.
Rocky Balboa?
Say it again. Oh,
Rocky Balboa.
Rocky Balboa. See? You're good.
Hey.
What were the first names of the two brothers who formed the band The Kinks? What were their first names?
Ray and Dave.
There you go. See? Music questions come in. What U.S. states end with the letter N? Believe it or not, I'll help you out. There's only four of them.
Wisconsin? Montanan? Californian? And New Jerseyan?
Yes! Amazing! Yes! Amazing!
Nailed it.
Because he lives in New Jersey.
I'm sorry, Bobby.
Charlie just thought he got yelled at.
I'm sorry, Charlie.
What was the tuna commercial, right? Sorry, Charlie. What? No?
Sorry, Charlie. Starkist.
Right, that's what I said.
Starkist.
Who was originally going to form Led Zeppelin with Jimmy Page? Music man.
Oh, Dorian Bradley got Michigan. And she got Oregon.
Ooh. Who was going to form Led Zeppelin with Jimmy Page? What two musicians?
Keith Moon?
Marianne Stone says I was. Yeah.
Was one of them?
No, Dennis, it was not David Clark. Keith Moon was one of them, yes.
I was Keith Moon and...
He's going to get it.
Was it Roger Daltrey?
No, close.
No, definitely Keith Moon.
There's only two other guys you can name now.
What, and from that, are they from that band?
Yeah.
Not John Entwistle.
Yeah.
Really?
Yep.
I didn't know. I knew Keith Moon, but I didn't know Entwistle.
It was Entwistle and Moon. Supposedly, Entwistle's the one who came up with the name. Supposedly.
Wow.
Okay. David Clark, finish this lyric. Monday, I could wait till Tuesday if I...
Monday, I can wait till Tuesday. If I make up my mind, Wednesday will be fine. Woo! Woo!
Nice. Giving him sting questions. He's got to get that right. That was kind of disturbing.
That was.
All right.
I'm out of breath, too. I'm like, too old for that. I pulled something.
Ow! Isn't your birthday coming up?
January 19th.
See that?
So is Gary Gonzalez's.
When's this?
January 16th.
Wow. Same year?
My mom. No, not the same year. Oh.
Your mom, what?
January 15th.
Oh, and your mom's in Florida?
She is.
I had the pleasure of meeting your mom once at the beach.
You did meet at the beach. She was head of security at the beach.
And your aunt, I feel like we met once.
You might have.
Might have, yeah. She was at the beach?
She was dancing.
Possible.
On the stage.
Possible.
Justin Bieber was going to form Led Zeppelin. Okay.
That's got to be Jeff Siegel. No?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, where was I? Alright, here's a hard one for you, Mr. Billy Joel Man. Name three bass players who have played with Billy Joel.
Skylar Diehl. Yeah, absolutely. Doug Stegmaier. Skylar Diehl, Doug Stegmaier. What's his name? He's got initials for his first name. Andy Chichone. Chichone?
All right, those are right, but how did he not name Larry Russell first? See, now I'm getting
you. I'm so in trouble!
I even now.
I'm so dead!
I'm like Larry Russell.
That's why I'm sitting there laughing. He's struggling for a
third. I thought you were making fun, like not listening.
I'm so dead.
You are.
I'm so in trouble, man.
Can you name any more?
The internet sucks!
But that was good though. You did name three.
You named a lot.
Let's see, Tony. Please put some makeup on your head. The glare is killing us.
Who said that?
Don Schroeder, my old friend, Don Schroeder. Oh, Patty Hoppy Maroney with the good answer. Howie Blogo. Wow, it's going back to the hasses. David's not up on his hasses. He should be.
I'm not up on any. I'm the worst Billy Joel fan on the planet. I don't know anything. Do you know what color the wallpaper was in his first bathroom in Hicksville? I don't fucking know.
I didn't ask you that.
I have no idea. People know crazy stuff about him.
Yes, which is ridiculous.
What street did he live on? I don't know. What type of music?
I'm actually.
I'm terrible with that stuff.
I'm friends with. Yeah, see, that stuff I don't like either. I don't care where he had a motorcycle accident. Stutz, are you watching? I don't care where he had a motorcycle accident. I don't care. You want to talk about his music and the musicians, I'm cool with that, and the lyrics, like, I like that kind of stuff, but, you know, where he first met Chrissy Brinkley, where he, you know, took a piss, you know, who cares? I actually know the girl in Hicksville who lives in his childhood home, and she actually emailed me once. She's like, can you reach out to these morons and tell them to stop taking pictures of my house? And she's right. So, knock it off.
Jeff Siegel said Andy would know what color the wallpaper was.
Oh man, Facebook Live video, the internet rocks.
Alright, here we go. In the hallways of the Enterprise, there are tubes marked with these letters, GNDN. Those initials stand for, and this is the original Star Trek, because I know you're just an original Star Trek fan.
Where are the letters?
GNDN.
No, where are they? On the outside or inside?
The tubes, like when you're like walking those hallways. If I remember right, it might have been the doors that opened, or maybe in the hallway themselves. I forget now. But they were all over the place. They were that much I remember. They were all over the place.
Wow, I don't know this.
GN.
All right, Marianne, enough with disease. This Is Us isn't on. You know, you got nothing else to watch. This is fun stuff.
I can't believe I did that. Wow.
He actually has a really nice voice.
All right.
I actually don't know that, man.
All right, moving on.
Yeah.
True or false?
Cool.
True or false? Sulu and Chekhov never sat side by side at the ship's helm and the weapon control on the bridge. They never sat in the front there. True or false? They never sat there together.
False.
I would say true.
Sure,
moving along. Well, we'll get to the answers. I want to see if anybody else is going to chime in. I think I saw a glass shatter. Yeah. Shatters with two T's, Don Schroeder. You made fun of my head, I make fun of your spelling.
Ooh.
That's a Hicksville.
That's shader.
That's a Hicksville education for you right there.
Hicksville education.
He'll play a little bit more music. Take it easy. Take it easy. Leonard Nimoy modeled Spock after who? And you will not believe this. But this is what I read.
Personality-wise, you mean?
Yes.
Okay. Is there a multiple choice?
No. All right, I'm going to do a few more trivia questions. We're going to get back to music.
Liz Weingard said Nixon.
I was going to say Lincoln.
And then Marianne saying, yeah, play Shattered. That's good. Yeah. All right, here's an easy one for you. The original Star Trek pilot featured a different captain. What was his name?
Pike.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, that's easy. Who was the first character to be on the receiving end of Spock's nerve pinch? You all right?
Jim is my guess.
Jim who?
Kirk.
No.
That is correct.
It was Kirk?
Yep. Another easy one. What century does Star Trek take place in?
23rd.
Thank you. Darth Vader.
Yeah.
Cuts off which of Luke's hands?
Darth Vader cuts off Luke's right hand.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Who has the first line in A New Hope? And believe it or not, I knew this. One of the only trivia questions that I actually knew.
C-3PO.
Very good. How old was Yoda when he passed away?
900.
Wow! All right, I'm impressed by that useless tidbit. Mm-hmm. Okay. Those were all the trivia questions. Who's burping? That was me. McCoy is incorrect.
Mr. I thought it was McCoy.
Okay. All right, so going back.
Yeah.
Let's see, GMDN stands for Goes Nowhere, Does Nothing. So what stands for?
Kind of like me. No. I'm kidding.
It is true that Sulu and Chekhov never sat side by side because there was a lack of money in the budget to pay them both in the same episode.
Oh, you're talking about in the episodes? Because in the movies they did.
My mistake. I was talking about the original series. I did not say that, though. So my
apologies. Actually, in the movies, they didn't. Wait a minute.
In the movies, they didn't either? No, I think they did. The movies,
maybe
yeah.
They did.
But in the original series, they did not. All right, now get this.
Not side by side?
Not side by side, no.
Wrath of Khan, Search for Spock. No. Go ahead, sorry.
That's all right. Leonard Nimoy modeled Spock after George Burns.
Really?
His amused and unflustered acceptances of Gracie Allen's ramblings influenced Spock's interactions with Dr. McCoy. Dave's like, what the hell am
it's
I
like
doing?
It's like the show,
here?
Man. It's a Galaxy Quest. I just watched the show, man.
I think it's a fine line of importance between the color of Billy's wallpaper and what year Yoda died.
No, not really. Not really.
All right. So. It's time to wrap up. Before we get to the last song,
sure.
If you wouldn't mind,
yeah.
Since my brother's in the hospital and he requested it twice, can we get a little tidbit of root beer red? I know that's a tough one, but I've seen you do it.
You just a little tidbit, right?
Tidbit.
How you doing, Frank?
Marianne, Kenny Sino, and who was it? Somebody else.
If he says Richard Marx, I'm going to kick him in the teeth.
No, it was not.
It wasn't?
But why? You're the big Richard Marx fan. Why?
No, Kenny is.
No, it's
no,
you.
No,
it's
you are.
Kenny made me play those things.
No,
Kenny Sino was not at the Richard Marx concert that you went to.
What?
You went to a Richard Marx concert just recently. Kenny wasn't there.
Richard Marx. Kenny loves Richard Marx.
As everybody should.
Angelina. Sorry.
Ed Frost says James. Ed, he played it.
I did
he played
it.
James. Watch the repeat. Watch the...
I'll do it at Frost Fest.
what was that? Metallica.
Yeah, it was.
All right, Billy Joel trivia. What song does Richard Marx sing on of Billy Joel's? He actually sings backup on the song.
Does he?
Yes, he does.
Wow, I'm as bad at Billy Joel trivia as I am apparently with Star Trek trivia. If I don't know what side Sulu sat on next to Chekhov, I couldn't tell you this.
Where's Timon? I'm sure Leonard knows what song Richard Marx sang on. He knows all things Billy. All right, we've had two requests. Kenny Sino, and I forget, my apologies, who else requested it, but Murder by Numbers was requested. Is that a piano tune? Is that something you can do?
We're going to make it one now. I've never done it on piano.
Are you going to see the Marx answer?
What's that?
What is the answer to that?
Oh, Stormfront.
Song?
The song Stormfront.
Safe at Harbor.
That one.
Okay.
Richard Marx sings back up on it. Alright. Murder by Numbers, David Bowie.
Alright, I've never done this on piano. Just give me a second.
Yeah.
Wow!
That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. The that little ow, that sting.
Oh!
How long did you learn that?
Years, man.
Scott Crosby's watching. John Morelli's watching.
Hi, I learned it easier and faster than root beer red. We put it that way.
All right, as we're saying goodbye.
Yes, sir.
Funeral for a Friend intro. Do you know that? That was a request.
No.
No. Okay, he doesn't know that. People are clapping. People are giving us the clapping emojis.
Give me the clap. Sorry.
Hey, that's David Clark.
Hey, that's Tony Walker.
David Clark, we've been friends for, I don't know, like 4 or 5 years now. Quickly became close friends. One of my favorite people, and I'm thrilled that he was here to help us out with this show. And like I said before, always supportive with Knock 'Em Dead Comedy, always around, always there. Just a great guy. Love the guy, even if he wasn't doing this stuff, but because he is doing this stuff, one of his biggest fans, and I thank you so much.
Thanks, man. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much. Thank you guys for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. Before we say goodbye, what do you got coming up? I know, was it Friday you're playing Rhode Island?
We are doing Stadium Theater Saturday night in Woonsocket, Rhode Island. January 20th, Ridgefield Playhouse with the Lords of 52nd Street.
Oh, that's in Connecticut, right?
January 17th. Every Breath You Fake, the Sting Tribute Show, Thursday, KJ Farrell's.
Oh, really?
Just booked it today.
Wait, well, I'm sorry, what was that?
January 17th.
Okay.
Thursday night, 7 o'clock, KJ Farrell's. Every Breath You Fake, the tribute to the police.
You did officially change the name to that.
Oh, yeah.
Every Breath You Fake.
Every Breath You Fake. Now, I didn't tell the drummer or the keyboard player yet, so I'm going to text him and let him know what I'm doing. Eric, if you're watching, Mike Jewell, if you're watching, we got a show at Farrell's January 17th, okay?
Kim Quaid Jansen, who was one of the people who requested Murder by Numbers, she is going to be in Woonsocket this weekend.
Nice!
Woo! That's what it says.
Sell out, baby! Woo!
Is that a Kenny Sino impression?
No.
Oh, because doesn't Kenny Sino do that?
Does he?
Yeah, right? We've seen him go woo! Like that.
Yeah.
Okay. Liz Weingart, what did she post there? The Songs in the Attic Band Facebook page. She posted a link.
Thank you, Liz.
Donna Smith Weston, great show. Thank you, Donna.
Everybody's so cool.
Everybody is
Everybody's
great.
So nice.
Appreciate you guys watching every week. This was a lot of fun, especially with a good friend like Dave. So we'll see you next week at 9 o'clock Tuesday night. Next Tuesday.
Tuesday
9. I don't know who our guest is going to be yet. We do have some great guests coming up within the next few weeks, but I don't know who. You all right?
Tuesday night with Tony. That's the Shatner Cadence.
Best show yet, says Jeff Siegel. All downhill from here, especially on February 23rd. Love the guys. Oh, that's Cindy Bradley says she loved it. Thank you, Cindy. Aww.
See you in a couple hours, honey. I'm stopping off for snacks. I'm going to stop off for healthy snacks on the way home.
Pet snacks?
No, human snacks.
Human snacks.
Human snacks, but I'll behave. I need snacks!
I can make you like a peanut butter and jelly sandwich for the road if you want. Just saying.
Gee, thanks for that, Sally.
Like stopping off and getting a bunch of junk.
We'll be live next Tuesday night at 9. Thanks for watching. Again, share the page, tell all your friends, hit the hearts and likes. There's the two. David Clark. Thank you, guys. We'll see you next week.
We're still on?
Yep.
Ah! I can't believe it!
Okay. All right. Bye.
You sure?
Yep.